It has been said the nuclear bomb ended World War II. But not many know that the small device called proximity fuse actually won the war for the Allies. So what is a proximity fuse and how did it change the outcome of World War II in favor of the Allies? Let's find out. Before World War II, there was no laser or GPS-guided bombs. In fact, if a warship needs to shoot down an aircraft, it would need to fire anywhere between 2,000 to 20,000 rounds of ammunition to shoot down a single aircraft. Before shooting, a gunner needs to accurately determine the altitude of the aircraft and then set a timer fuse for the shell to explode at a particular height and time. But this is very manual and inaccurate. The aircraft can very well change the altitude in course of flight and the rounds would explode harmlessly. This method made warships run out of anti-aircraft ammunition while on long cruises and would be sitting ducks for the bombers. During World War II, there were two broad categories of fuses, impact and timed. Impact fuses, sometimes known as crush fuses, goes off when they actually hit the target. This is great for hitting armored targets where you need the explosion pressed as closely as possible against the hull. The timer fuses, on the other hand, went off after a predetermined set time, but small math errors could lead to the round going off too early and harmlessly. By 1940, British military researchers at the Telecommunication Research Establishment conceived the idea of a proximity fuse. The proximity fuse worked by sending out radio waves and then measuring the time it takes for those waves to bounce back, allowing it to detonate at a set distance from the object. This required shrinking down a radio transmitter and receiver until it was small enough to fit in a space allotted for the fuse. The miniaturization was possible, but this was the age of the bulky vacuum tubes, no semiconductors or transistors. The vacuum tubes which needed to be used in the proximity fuse were made of glass and hence very fragile. Moreover, the shell fired from a cannon would experience something around 20,000 Gs, and also the cannon tube was rifled, and that would rotate the shell, adding some 30,000 revolutions per minute. So the scientists needed to find a fuse that would survive and would work under these harsh conditions. Enter Dr. James Van Allen. This is the same scientist after whom the Van Allen radiation belt is named. Dr. Van Allen took up the challenge of making the proximity fuse work after he joined Johns Hopkins University in 1942. He, along with other British scientists, succeeded in miniaturizing the vacuum tubes of the proximity fuse, but their main hurdle was to make the fuse survivable. To make the glass tough, a special type of soda available only in England was used in the manufacturing process. Four such vacuum tubes were used in the design. These tubes needed to transmit and receive radio signals and later amplify the received signal to trigger the detonation of the charge. The entire circuit was then covered with a special wax that functioned as a shock absorber. The battery used for the fuse was not a normal dry-cell battery, which has a low shelf life. Instead, an acid battery was used, which flowed into the case only after the shell is fired. Also, a special capacitor circuit was added to cause a time delay and to avoid detonation in the barrel. Hence, the circuit was fully activated only after the shell was out of the barrel. The proximity fuse shells were first used in 1942 at Guadalcanal in Pacific, where USS Helena, one of the first of the three ships to receive it, fired on a Japanese dive bomber heading for its task force. The Helena fired two rounds and the fuse's first victim burst into flames before plunging to a watery grave. By 1943, every other Allied warship in the Pacific was using the proximity fuse shells, and the Japanese were thoroughly shocked and confused at the accuracy of the American artillery. During the Battle of the Philippine Sea in 1944, US gunners brought down over 500 Japanese planes. Secrecy was crucial. In spite of its success, the proximity fuse was vulnerable to jamming. The proximity fuse signals can be jammed if a 50-watt transmitter is fitted in the underbelly of the plane. Due to this reason, the Allies used the proximity fuse fitted shells only in the sea so that the enemy would not have the chance to recover and inspect these shells. The proximity fuse reduced the number of shells to bring down an aircraft from 2,500 to just 500 shells. The success of the proximity fuse led to the further development, and a decision was taken to use it in land-based artillery shells. Ordinary mortar and artillery shells are useless against enemy troops hiding in trenches, as the shell would throw all the debris on the top and the enemy is unharmed. Now with the proximity fuse, the artillery shells can be made to burst 10 feet above the ground and the shrapnel would hit the enemy hard. On a foggy night during the Battle of the Bulge, General George S. Patton's troops lined up and began shelling German tank roofs. More shells with the impact fuses would have detonated on the ground, but Patton's men fired shells with the proximity fuses designed to detonate 10 feet above the ground, creating lethal storms of shrapnel. More than 22 million proximity fuses were made during World War II at the cost of over $1 billion. After the nuclear bomb and the radar, the proximity fuse is considered the most innovative weapon that brought complete victory to the Allies. The artillery shells fitted with the proximity fuse became the forerunners of the smart bombs that we use today. If you like the video, please subscribe and share. Thanks for watching.